Hello and welcome to Explore the Symphony. I'm your host, Marjolaine Fournier, Assistant Principal Bass with the National Arts Center Orchestra. My guest, Jean-Jacques van Vlasselaer, is one of Canada's foremost music journalists, credited with over 60 articles for Le Droit, The Globe and Mail, and CBC Radio-Canada. In this series, we discuss the inspiration, lives, and music of great composers. This season, we're studying music that changed music. Hello and welcome to Studio P3. I'm sitting here with Jean-Jacques van Vlasselaer, and we're having our first conversation of the season as part of the Explore the Symphony series. And this year we're going to be talking about music that changed not only music in time, but how we listen to music. And what better than Mahler's First Symphony to do that? Jean-Jacques, hello.
Hello, how are you, Marceline?
Very well, but I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say.
We're starting with an immense work, of course. One of those works that changed the course of listening over the few centuries that we have had our so-called classical music. Mahler's First Symphony, which is the beginning of a whole series of symphonies, which for Mahler are the expression both of his inner world and the world in which he has evolved, which is, of course, the world of the old Austrian monarchy, the empire, which is in its dying days. And it's also the end of the 19th century, and with its Weltschmerz, with its very dramatic complexity of that spiritual atmosphere which was around Vienna at the end of the century and in the beginning of the 20th century. So there you have Mahler, born in 1860, died in 1911, 1860, very soon, 150th anniversary of his birth, very soon, the year afterwards, 100th anniversary of his death, and we will hear most probably a lot of Mahler. And it is wonderful that at the National Arts Center we have the first symphony almost in the beginning of the season, and at the end of the season, the 8th symphony, which we call the Symphony of the Thousand, because it needs a very large orchestra, several choirs, and a lot of singers to get into that. So Mahler is part of this, and he will be the expressive moment, I think, of the end of the Romantic era, because he's a romantic person as such, and the beginning of what the 20th century will be about. He is the 20th century. Well, his symphonies are not anymore those classical symphonies which he admires absolutely. Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven. He has a passion for Beethoven, as he has also a passion later for Wagner. The symphonies by Mozart are those classical symphonies. They start with a subject, and that subject does a tour and gets back to the beginning. And these are perfect circles. Time is closed in time. With Beethoven, the subject is a victorious subject. It's an active subject. It's the working subject. It's the one that takes the fires away from the gods, but is running his own life. In the Mahler symphonies at the end of the century, about 50, 60, 70 years later, you will have the subject is lost. The subject wanders. The subject doesn't know where he will end up off. Of course, that is the end of the century, which Nietzsche has called God is dead. So there's nobody to guide you anymore. And you're bypassed by societal events. Marx has written his books. You're bypassed by internal events, subconscious. Freud is somebody who's living in Vienna at that time and who will meet for one meeting Mahler, where Mahler will explain his youth to him on a beach somewhere in Holland, where both of them were staying at that very time. And it was in the beginning of the 20th century. So We have there a symphonic world which where time is not a closed in time anymore, but where time is a psychological time. It is the time of the subject trying to find his way through the world. That's why the symphonies by Mahler are not what we call, and I put it between quotation marks, these are not pure symphonies anymore. Beethoven symphonies are pure symphonies. They have the road is very clear. They go from one point to another point. With him, these are whole truth, and again, quotation marks, whole truth symphonies, in which the sounds of the world come in. Trumpet sounds that come from his youth, the sounds of nature, Naturlaut, that invade the symphonies left and right. So the roads of the subject is a road in which he is wandering and wandering. With at the end of the symphony, of course, always this extraordinary thought of death. Even if it's in his first symphony, which is a symphony of youth, well, death is very present in the symphony of youth.
So when you say death, you're saying not hope or death with hope together?
Death with hope together, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, there is always the glorification of nature and of life. He loved life. He was a walker, a mountain climber, a swimmer. Very good. He was a very sportsy person. And I have never been, at the end of his life, he said, I've never been so full of life. But at the same time, he is somebody who looks death straight into the eyes. And doesn't run away from it like the classics, and doesn't run away or doesn't find internal paradises to run away from it like the romantics. No, he is very clear. He sits in front of it and he works it out. So it is what Hegel, the philosopher, called. These symphonies are what Hegel called the bad course of the world. You know, in the beginning of the century, everything was optimism. You know, Haydn is optimism. Mozart is the discovery of the self. And Beethoven is the discovery of the willpower of the self. And, you know, we'll make it and we'll take over the society and we'll, up to a certain point, we'll take the place of the gods. But when there is no God anymore, and when you don't know exactly where you're running, and where you are in that kind of absurdity, which will give us Kafka, and later Albert Camus, the French writer. So it's the bad course of the world, and these symphonies are the representation of the bad course of the world.
So you're explaining a little bit what goes into the symphonies, mm-hmm. and I understand a little bit better. I wanted to ask you why, like in the First Symphony, for example, and we can talk about Nietzsche and God and being a Jew or being a Christian and the Virgin Mary and all this, but first of all, in his music, in this first movement, it starts so peacefully and then there's trumpet fanfares. When I hear a trumpet fanfare, I expect something big will happen. And nothing happens, really. So you're telling me that as part of his music, memory mm-hmm. happens.
You see, what I was telling is that his symphonies are like the novels of Proust, the French writer. You know, memory comes back regularly. And flashes of the future come in there also. And the road is not straight. It's never straight. You know, we know about this in the beginning of this 21st century. You know, this is total optimism is certainly gone. It was totally stupid in a way. Mm-hmm. What he's showing is this new road. The I, the me, still exists, but it's on a distorted road. And it's distorted by your memory, by your hopes, by your false hopes, by things that happen to you. Are we the puppets of God? You know, that's one of those questions that I've been very much asked at but I do think that for him, he will replace God by sound. His God will be sound. And that's why he's also a very great conductor. And that is, and all these elements have been helping him in creating those symphonies, which are his personal road very much, very much. I put myself fully, he says after the first and the second symphony, I put myself fully. Those that can listen will know what I am and where I am. And, you know, this is, his persona is very much involved in those symphonies. These are autobiographical works.
Well, they are, and this is clear to you, and they're clear to him also. And I think he wrote some notes and explanatory descriptive notes to help his audience, because at first it wasn't a big hit, his symphony, but he had this title, Titan. And he tried to write notes, and then he realized his notes were, they weren't helping anything. So can you explain that?
Yes, but he will write notes, and then afterwards he will say, I did that, so that, and unfortunately people didn't understand or took them too seriously, so there are no notes. My music is absolute music. You have to listen to it as such, you see? And he got away from that at a given moment. He got away from that, and he wanted to people to listen to his symphonies without reading too much of his own personal notes into it. So there has been an internal fight for Mahler about that. But the first symphony which you mentioned is you mentioned those trumpet calls. Well, trumpet calls. He when he was a little boy in Iglau, in a little city in Moravia, it was a garrison city, and so he would hear the fanfares around him, and he put together those waking up calls in the morning very often with those fanfares. He tells Freud the story, the following story. His parents didn't, it was not a happy marriage, his parents' marriage. A big fight happened one day. By the way, they had 14 children, and 7 of them died in early. And Mahler was the second of those of the 14, and then one other one died when he was 9 years old, and then Otto died when he was in the early 20s,
suicide. Yeah.
And he was certainly as gifted as Gustav.
No,
yeah, he was at the university at the conservatory. And Gustav helped him at that time because he was much older than Otto. So I'm saying this, you know, this was a big family. This was a 19th century family. Mother was quite religious, so he was brought up as a Jewish boy. That the latest research on that is quite clear. The parents fought. And so he ran out of the house one day and got into the street. And there was a man on his organ, you know, playing, "Oh, du lieber Augustin, Augustin, Augustin." This very, you know, folkloric song. And Mahler has always put drama together suddenly with this song about Lieber Augustin, the clown, you know. And so there is the clown part, the difference, it's full of differences. His symphonies will be full of opposites and explosions. And they're not straight roads. That's what I'm coming to. And you, in the midst of a drama, in the midst of a very tense moment in his symphonies, suddenly you will change into a Lieber Augustin.
Because that's how life is.
And that's what life is about.
And you're making me think also that organ, the grinder, I don't know what you call this, an Orgue de Barbarie.
Orgue de Barbarie, yes.
Is, never quite in tune, and so it's a little mad, eh? It's a happy tune, out of tune, on top of something very sad.
And his symphonies, the more you go forward when you get into the 8th, and especially in the 9th symphony, and the beginning of the 10th symphony, whatever he had composed on the 10th symphony, you will get into the atonal world. He's opening up towards Schönberg, the second school of Vienna. And not only them, he does all kinds of other things in his symphonies, which will open up to Hindemith and to Prokofiev, but these are technical elements, and I don't want to get too much into that. But here is the man who has he has all the past, and he's opening up to the future. So his symphonies are unlimited, but that's what he wanted. He said, when there are limits to a work, death enters. And that is Dostoevsky also, in fact. You know, when you finish your house, says Dostoevsky, death enters. So never finish your house. Never finish. And that is also the end of the 19th century. These people represent their time, but these people are beyond their time also. They are so immense that a man like Mahler has, in fact, opened up to the catastrophes of the 20th century.
Something for the new listener of a Mahler symphony. You want to cultivate yourself. There's two things that you need to know. What are the good versions? But also, when you sit down with Mahler, whether it's in a live concert or on record, how do you dispose yourself? Are you expecting a trip, a long trip? Or because sometimes, like my first auditions of Mahler, I feel like it's a big machine. All the voices are very present, and it's hard to detect where the real paths are from the little paths. And what do you listen to? How do you dispose yourself, your mind, your ears to listen?
You know, you're walking into a symphony like that, and you're on a path, and suddenly the path is broken. There is no end to the path, and you'll have to return. And then you take another part of the, you get into the mountain, and you find another path, and there is another rupture. And his symphonies are ruptured symphonies. They're broken off symphonies. There is somebody used the image of a broken glass in which he reflects the images of the world. That is our symphonies, and I like it. I like it very much because the broken glass goes to the past, but also captures the light of the sun, which takes you to the future. I mean, this is, and so I do think you have to, sit down, let yourself be taken, but be all ears. Listen to the beauty of all those instruments trying to tell their story. He will use instruments as individualists, and especially the colors of the instruments.
He liked to exploit the weird registers, eh? Well, nowadays, with the progress of factor of flutes and basses and strings and everything, but...
He opens dimensions, and so he goes to new sounds within the instruments. He tries to create new sounds. We were talking before this meeting about why did he change the one instrument for another instrument, the cello for the double bass, for example, because the double bass is so much more extreme in what he wanted to say at that very moment. The cello would have been a regular classical instrument. You know, what he does, what Berlioz will do also in a way, is he uses the brass instruments to give the tune at a given moment, and not the regular string instruments that what normally was given, or the woodwinds. No, and so all these things are trying to break out of the regular pattern. And the breaking out of the regular pattern is what he wants to show, what that new world is about. What that new world is about, both outside, which comes from outside, which bypasses him in a way, but which he represents absolutely remarkably well as a great composer.
We haven't spoken about this yet, but and you're talking about colors and a composer of the future, but he was first for his living, and first and foremost, how he was known was as a conductor of opera. Not only a conductor, but especially conductor of opera. And I was reading that he had developed a theory that what would be smart would be a pit, an orchestra pit for opera that would rise and fall depending on the repertoire.
Absolutely.
How very clever. And we do that now. So
his God was sound. His God was sound.
Yeah, so he that's what we do everywhere now. So he was very much deep in the past, conducting past operas, actual operas that were just written.
Absolutely.
And then he was
contemporary
leading
operas.
So tell us about this. Well, how come, first of all, how come he conducted operas? He didn't write operas.
Okay. Well, there are several questions in here.
Yes.
First, one has to see that until the end of that century, until Mahler's time, all conductors, most of the time, until that time, most conductors were composers. Composers were conductors. This was the kind of pattern. You know? Mozart conducted his works. Beethoven conducted his works until he didn't hear. Even at the time, he didn't hear anymore. You know, and Schumann conducted, and Mendelssohn was one of those great conductors, and Mahler is a conductor who will be setting the pattern of the contemporary 20th century orchestra and the orchestras that we still know together today. On the other hand, conductors at that time only from time to time conducted concerts. Conducting was opera. That's why they were such great conductors. That's why we have a whole different kind of conductors these days, because they don't conduct opera. Now, the third part of your question is, why didn't he compose operas? Well, there is a saying that Wagner brought the symphony orchestra into the opera. Mahler brought the opera into the symphony orchestra. That means the sounds of voices, all those instruments are voices. And that's the answer, and that's how you should listen to the orchestra playing. They're all individual voices. Sometimes it's very difficult to take, but when you learn it, then you see what an extraordinary world he's giving to you, and a new world, and a world that is saying what our future was about in the 20th century. Okay, that's one thing. This brings us to the First Symphony. Because in the First Symphony, it's full of voices. He brings in many of his Lieder, and especially the Songs of the Wayfarer. Two of the Lieder of the cycle, the Songs of the Wayfarer, are in that symphony, in the first movement and in the third movement. In the first movement, it is this morning I went walking over the field. It's the wanderer theme. It's a wanderer theme, which where Mahler is the is in fact a follower of Schubert. And in the third movement, in the so-called funeral march, so-called funeral march, where in the middle part he says, through the song, two blue eyes of my darling, how to escape from reality through sleep. How to escape from reality, escape the thoughts of death through sleep. It's a very, very, very interesting part, that middle part.
It's a very human.
And it's a very much, I don't want to know about all this, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm tired of thinking that death is looking into my eyes. And so there we go. Four movements for that first symphony, which is introduced by a hushed introduction, which are by the strings, which is the infinity of nature. And then, of course, where suddenly you have those fanfares and the cuckoo song coming in. So you have both Naturlaut, the song, the sound of nature, on this infinity, and the sounds of culture, which is the military culture, which he knew. And so the visions of youth some memories coming back, nostalgia, loss of innocence through the romantic horn song, appeals that come in, and the world is opening up, and then suddenly you have that theme of walking through the fields. And a wander walk.
And it's quite happy. Right?
And it's pastoral and it's wonderful, yes. And it goes, you know, and it goes to a climax and then it comes back to tranquility because we are at noon hour and it's the warmth of noon hour. But in the middle, there is some mysterious stillness, out in that second part, in the first movement. And the walking tune will come back. The horn calls awaken the dreamer again. The melody of the walker comes back, and then there is a more anguished part following. The anguished part has to do most probably with his memories. His father took him into the woods one day. This is a story that he tells about the first symphony and the first movement. His father took him into the woods, said, "Wait for me here, I'll return." And this little boy, he must have been 6 or 7, this little boy sits there, and the father does not return. He only returned hours and hours later. And that anguish was still in, and he shows it in that part of the first movement of the first symphony. So, and that sweeps then in a terrifying climax, and then we have the a nice D major to finish that exuberant first movement. Yeah. So you see, these are memories. He's walking through his youth in that first movement.
And you're describing something very, you said pastoral, and I was thinking while you were talking, you know, the cuckoo,
yeah.
I was thinking of Beethoven's pastoral and that lovely theme in this symphony, mm-hmm. in the first pop, mm-hmm. pop, 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 pop. It's a long walk, a long and quiet mm-hmm. river, nothing. Mm-hmm. But then you tell me this crazy story of
and
him
then the
being
crazy
left
story that comes. And that's why there are those movements in the first in that first symphony that are torn movements. One and he shows it in the music. So just follow and try to imagine this little boy, this Mahler little boy. Mahler is, when he composes this symphony, my God, he's 25 years old. 25 years old? How many 25 years old have composed a work like that, going in depth? He will do it in his second movement, which is a Ländler, you know, one of those peasant dances. And he goes back to another song, Hans und Grete. And you see the stampings and the yodelings of that. And it is the primitive pleasures of life at the countryside, you know, which is an ideal. Yes, that comes the closest to happiness. So, and then the famous third movement on the basis of that the nursery rhyme, Frère Jacques in French, Bruder Jakob in German, and I think Brother Martin in English, and which he uses in the first and the third section of that movement. Now, people have called it a funeral march. It's a kind of ironic takeoff of that Brother Martin theme, and very Jewish modulation of the tempo and of the sounds also, and so he will. It becomes an eerie fairy tale, you know. So one of the things that you don't want to have too often in your nightmares, and it is. What does he use? Well, this is a good example for Mahler's usage of instruments. So on the muffled drum beat, there is a muted solo double bass who sings. The solo bass sings that melody first, and then the toy-like fanfare on the oboe, the acute, a biting oboe that goes on it, and that which of course aids poignancy to it. But I told it's the first and the third part, and in the middle, what does he do? He uses the zwei blaue Augen von meinen Schatz, the two blue eyes of my darling, to show the escape from reality through sleep. And then at the end, you know, the phantom, the specter enters again, and there is, you know, the movement will fade into darkness. So it's an extraordinary moment. I mean, and then of course the fourth movement, the last movement, opens, as he calls it himself, with a cry of a wounded heart, a dissonant cry of the woodwinds and of the brass instruments, and this is very anguished music, and of course intensified by the vision of death, and then it will go into a triumphal march. The hero. And that was the title, Titan. It comes from a book by Jean-Paul, who was a German famous author, and it's the story of a hero, and ultimately the hero takes over. He's young, he's 25, Mahler, and so there must be something good, and we'll vanquish, we'll get there. And at the end of this symphony, there's a wonderful ending of the symphony for all instruments, you know, we have all these horns getting up, standing, you know, he asked the horns to stand up. And
they play with the bell up, right?
That's spectacular. Absolutely. They turn the
instrument
in the air. It's like eight horns, no?
That
depends. It should be eight horns, but it could be. Sometimes there are less horns. There is a famous story about that in the 1950s in France. There was a. I shouldn't tell stories. I mean, this is a.
Please.
But in the 1950s, the Orchestre du Conservatoire, people would go to the rehearsals and then not go to the second rehearsal. And like some in the London orchestras, very often happened, and still happen from time to time. I've seen conductors getting very angry about that. Didn't I tell you that yesterday? You know, oh, I wasn't there yesterday. You know, and so so one of the horn players has to in the first symphony. He has something to do, you know, family business. So he goes to his concierge and he says to his concierge, the only thing you have to do, there are eight horns, he said, the only thing you have to do when they get up at the end, you just do as if you're playing. So there comes the night of the concert, and we get into the last movements, the horn players stand up, they get to the moment, the conductor gives their signal, no sound, eight concierges. Well,
perfect. Well, Jean-Jacques, I just wish we could talk some more about this. We just have a small idea. I am very much looking forward to speaking to you again on this subject of music that's changed the way we listen to music.
Absolutely.
Looking forward to talking again.
So do I.
Thank you.
That's all for this edition of Explore the Symphony. Send your comments and questions to nacpodcasts@gmail.com. We look forward to hearing from you. Check out our sister podcast, the NACO Cast, with the NAC Orchestra's principal bassoon, Christopher Millard. You can subscribe to this and other NAC podcasts by visiting nacpodcast.ca or searching for NAC CNA in the iTunes Music Store. Musical excerpts provided by Naxos of Canada. So until next time, this is Marjolaine Fournier saying thank you and goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.